future, talk radio will actually educate, inspire, and make you think. The future is now. Topics and music that affect your life from Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com.
Thank you to all of our fans around the country and around the world. You have tuned in to another edition of Focus with Ron Frierson. I am your host, Ron Frierson. Is the mic okay with us here, Jarvis? Yeah, turn the mic up a little bit. I'm about to spit 16 bars. I'm joking. Everybody, thank you for joining us for another edition of Focus with Ron Frierson. I'm your host, Mr. Ron Frierson. And to my left here, I have my partner, my collaborator, my co-host, Mr. Woody Wilson.
What's up? What's up, Ron?
And I have my brother here, Mr. Kyle Cox.
Yeah, welcome, Kyle.
Thank you. Kyle is a military veteran and the president and CEO of BallerzWorld, and we're going to talk about Kyle's technology company in a few minutes. And for all of our listeners that normally tune in, you know I start with my rant. And this is near and dear to me because I'm from Michigan, and I have to give shout out to Kyle for wearing the Michigan gear.
I had to represent.
Kyle went to Michigan. Yeah, he's alumni. He's from Cali, but he's alumni. He went to Michigan, so okay. we adopt him there. Well, this is about NAFTA, and President Trump, NAFTA was adopted in 1993 by President Bill Clinton. Well, President Trump at one point said that he was going to just do away with NAFTA, withdraw from NAFTA. He was saying this all during the campaign trail. He learned very quickly that that's probably not going to be a good idea. And so now he's thinking about renegotiating NAFTA. So for all of us out there that don't know what NAFTA is, that's the North American Free Trade Agreement. And basically it allows for a free flow of goods between Canada, United States, and Mexico. All right. So in layman's term, it helps companies trade back and forth, mostly making rich people richer, which is fine. Now, all that being said, one thing that NAFTA, one reason was so controversial is that one of the things that it allowed for was for countries and companies to take advantage of low-skilled, cheap labor. Now, the United States is over 320 million of us. There's only 35, 36 million Canadians, and there's only 127 million Mexicans. And so the size of Mexico and Canada both combined are still smaller than the United States. Okay? So that means the United States is the biggest consumer market. All right? So that means all of these two smaller countries, they want to be able to sell their goods in the United States because this is where all the buyers are. And, you know, per capita, we have more discretionary income than those other countries. So this is good for them. The way it's good for us, and remember, I'm going to quantify when I say us. The way it's good for us is that we can have our goods manufactured in many places in these other countries for less, because labor is the bulk of cost when it goes into anything. It's labor. Insurance, which is benefits, child care, all of these things, pension plans, all these things, these incorporated costs that companies have to pay. If they can pay someone else in another country, like in Mexico, to do that for a lot cheaper, that's what they're going to do. So I actually have problems with NAFTA too. But it's so ingrained into who we are, and there's so much involved with it, even national security, that it makes us have to really look at this delicately. And I don't know if Trump is sophisticated enough, hopefully the people around him are, but sophisticated enough to see in total what this means. So from there, I'm going to ask my two guests here, well, my one guest, my one normal big head brother that's here, that's been gone for a couple of
my
weeks.
My head is smaller than yours.
Yeah, that's true. I do have a big head. I'm a big dude, too. But anyway, so what do you guys think about President Trump's stance towards NAFTA?
Well, you know, I think you should get in there and make some changes. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I think it's an unfair setup that we've got going on. But, you know, good luck to him. I mean, he just admitted that this job is a lot harder than he thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
So, you know, like you said, I hope there's folks around him that are experts enough to figure this out, you know.
Yeah.
What you think, man?
I think one thing that I've noticed is that I think it's kind of, I'll get sociological real quick, but yeah. Capitalism is built on, one of its foundational tenets is exploitation of labor.
That's right.
And we can't function without cheap labor. It started off with slavery.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And that's the reason this country became so powerful. Then it went to indigenous people, then it went to foreigners and, you know, and what it is now.
Exactly.
So I think, like you said, I think it's almost that, go back to that too big to fail
exactly.
situation, where it's like we're so deep into it now that the only thing he could really fix probably just destroy it all and start mm-hmm. over from scratch mm-hmm. because cheap labor is one of our tenets. It's one of the founding principles of capitalism.
Exactly. And you know,
it doesn't work without it.
But you know, one thing that, and I'm a capitalist, but one of the things that really bothers me is that, and it goes along with the tax policy that he's talking about as well, and saying that, you know, companies can keep more. Companies have record profits. Yeah. And we have other industries. We have companies like Deloitte and Touche and Ernst & Young and PricewaterhouseCoopers, and they have vast, huge empire-sized companies that are built on helping rich people stay rich.
Right.
And helping these companies not have to pay taxes.
Right.
So that's a whole – so if you simplify the
tax –
how much more of a break can they get? But no one's talking about demand.
Mm-hmm.
The thing that's going to allow for more jobs to be created is not how much more money the companies have to spend because they save this much on taxes. It's how much more the consumer has to buy yeah. the product that the company is trying to sell.
Mm-hmm.
It's like they don't understand that relationship. That relationship between the consumer having discretionary income so that they can go out and purchase something or purchase more of something, that means the demand for that certain product will go up. So that means the company has to create more of that product. And so that company say, okay, to create more of that product, we need to hire more people. We need to build more plants and this and the other. It's like they just think that by giving the people at the very top more, that somehow that's going to make them just become more gracious.
Trickle down economics.
That's the illusion of trickle down.
But that's common sense. But Trump, he has people really believing that to a certain extent. Like he's saying that, okay, this industry is going to come back. This industry is going to come back. We're going to bring this back. We're going to bring that back. And he knows that's not the case.
Yeah.
He knows it's not the case.
I don't know. I think he believes that he can make those changes.
You really think he believes that?
I think he believes it. I think he believes everything he says.
Well, he's kind of backtracked on a lot of things already.
He has. Some of it is good, though.
It's that you're like, man, I don't want to catch myself saying that was a good move. You know,
yeah, exactly.
It's like, if you're going to be completely objective, then, yeah, him not doing some of those things was actually a good flip.
That's very true. I have some things written down here, but before I go there, I'm going to say, you know, kind of stick on the NAFTA thing really quick. So we spoke about the major component is labor,
mm-hmm.
and each of these NAFTA countries, they have companies and their politicians that got together and formed this agreement, and they formed this agreement for the benefit of all those three. When I say those three, I'm not saying just the countries. I'm talking about those specific shareholders within that country, mm-hmm. those companies that can mm-hmm. benefit from this free trade agreement. So now what people aren't talking about that is that the vast majority of the jobs aren't going to Mexico. The vast majority of the jobs are disappearing through innovation
mm-hmm.
and technology. Because again, the highest cost associated with any company for the most part is going to be labor.
Right.
So if you can supplant labor, you don't have to worry about if you can make a robot to efficiency.
Tired.
You don't have to worry about the robot pregnant. Getting tired.
24 hours a
you
day.
Don't have to worry about a union.
No yeah. pregnancy.
No pregnancy, no exactly. Yeah. No child care. No pension plan.
24 hours a day.
Exactly.
Overnight.
You don't have to worry about mm-hmm. any of that. Mm-hmm. And that's
no
the
hangovers?
Vast majority of those jobs are going. It's because of innovation. Why aren't they telling the people this and being honest with them and upfront with them. I don't get
I
it.
I always wondered about that, but we talked about it on previous shows, how those jobs aren't coming back. And what do you do to educate yourself and prepare yourself for the future? You know, it's got to be, you've got to, you know, be able to write code or I don't know, fly a droid or something, but you've got to change your perspective on what's out there. I mean, go ahead.
I was going to say, I'll piggyback what you said. You hit it dead on. It's the people are afraid to learn a new skill. This is not, it's not even a whole, not a new skill like you're going to learn how to like be weld or something like that. No, you have to change your entire mindset to get behind coding. If you can't program, it's kind of what, you know, my motivation for what I was doing, we'll get into later, I guess. But you, if you can't program, you better know how to fix it, or you better know how to operate it. So those are the three things that you better, you know what I mean?
Some
those
ancillary are the jobs. Or peripheral industry associated, directly support. Associated with that.
Exactly. That and that's where the jobs are. Like, nobody's going to use code. Remember they said the 70,000 jobs, but 600,000 were made in green and new technology.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and
that's true. Yeah. So I wonder whether or not, okay, we all can go back to where the horse and buggy had to, it was done away with, and then you have the automobile, and that's done away with. But
what do you mean that the automobile is done away with?
I mean, well, I'm sorry, I shouldn't say the automobile. I mean, the horse and buggy got, it pushed the automobile out the way. I guess that's what I'm saying. But even with the automobile manufacturer coming from Michigan, there used to be a time where people are sitting on the plant floor. Right. You know, drilling a drill, and and now that is being supplanted so now you have to be one of the people who are building those robots or programming those robots, and that's
or fixing it.
Now, but even with that being said, the population is steadily increasing. These different types of technologies foster efficiency, so now you don't need as many people. You can have one person make a program that's going to build, you know, or program 1,000 robots, so you don't need 1,000 people for each robot. So that means you can have fewer people doing more because of, you know, because of technology.
Right.
So when you have that along with the growing population, you're still going to have to be able to provide jobs at each tier of this economy.
There's a funnel.
Back in our father's times and grandfather's times, you know, there's always been layers in capitalism. You know, you have the people making as much, but depending on your education level or your skill set. But at that time, it was easier to find something within those different tiers. So if you had low skill labor, you can go and work for GM and work on a plant. If you had a little education, you can be a foreman or something like that. If you have more education, you can go into something else. But now it seems like there's whole swaths.
Now you got to work at Starbucks.
This,
you know?
Drive Uber.
And truck drivers are going to be out of business in 10 years.
Because Elon Musk has he's developing the trucks that can
just drive themselves.
All the self-destruct, they can go all night.
And he bought a solar company. He's going to throw solar on the rooftops.
They can drive all day and all night. Drive all day.
And I actually heard that, and maybe Jarvis could do some research. I've heard that a driver is the number one occupation for men in this country.
Probably driver so. In wow. some I mean, look at all the taxis you see in every city, and Uber drivers now. And
that's the number. Just think about if you put these different types, whether it's a bus driver, whether it's a, you know, I still don't want no robot flying the plane. I want
somebody. But it will happen one day.
I hope not, because I want somebody with some skin in the game. I don't want just if a robot decides to crash, he don't care. But if a pilot has to get home to his family too, I feel better about him.
It sits on autopilot for like most of the trip.
Except for takeoff and landing.
It's on autopilot the whole time.
That's
the most important part.
Exactly. So with all that being said, you know, that in itself is a disruptive thing too, in regards to, so where do the new jobs come from? The jobs are going to come from technology, but is that it?
Well, you know, that's the question.
Yeah.
You know, that is the question. What do you study? What do you prepare yourself for?
Yeah.
What is going to be available to you? How are you going to support your family if these jobs are going to be eliminated? And if so, if males, the primary or the largest employment opportunity right now is drivers,
and that's gone.
What happens to all those males? They join the army? What do they do?
That's going to be the main. That's pretty much what I was going to say. You're going to have to join the army.
You think that really?
But that's even becoming obsolete at this point.
Right.
Because I was in the Navy, and just one of my observations was, we're the only ones with a Navy. we're the world's Navy. So we're out there really. Other people have
Great
boats.
Great Britain doesn't have
they have ships, but it's not on the level of us. So that like if we went to a old school in the middle of the ocean, Game of Thrones, ocean fight, no one would stand a chance.
Yeah,
we have more. We have 14 aircraft carriers. The rest of the world maybe has two combined. Wow. Three, you know.
We only have 14.
We cut down, but they're building new ones all the time.
So that kind of goes towards the military industrial complex too. Mm-hmm. And that's something we're going to talk. Let's go to a commercial break real quick and we'll continue this conversation when we come back.
Yep.
Right.
Hi, I'm Dr. Yates. I'm a hair transplant surgeon. When people come to see me, they have a problem. They've lost a lot of hair and they want their hair back. We have our own line of hair products, and I think it's a real winner. The way we start is with Mega Biotin. Number two, edge control. It prevents breakage and holds the edges down. Apple cider vinegar shampoo, it adds body, it adds shine, and it also reduces inflammation. Depending on if your hair is dry, you want to use hydrating. If your hair is thin, you use the thickening shampoo. Then we have our secret sauce, argan oil. With that, we have what's called Miracle Blowout. The Sheen Spray is basically kind of a permutation of the argan oil. It just adds a finishing touch to the hair. And finally, the Dynamic Duo, keratin fibers. This makes your hair look thicker instantaneously. This doesn't come out in the wind, doesn't come out in the rain. We can guarantee this will help your hair and keep you from coming to see me about hair loss.
Jivago timepieces are luxury watches for both women and men. Designs for women are inspired by classic femininity while maintaining their contemporary style. Designs for men blend classic elegance and sporty versatility. All timepieces remain true to the Jivago lifestyle, including their glamorous presentation, which is a nod to the famous Parisian fragrance that started it all. Jivago timepieces transcend the ages, recalling life's most treasured moments. Let Jivago inspire you.
Visit www.jivagowatches.com or shop Jivago Watches on Amazon.
Where does your favorite restaurant get its bread? Do they make it themselves? If not, make sure your favorite restaurant uses Artisan Crust Bakery for all their baked goods. 100% natural, 100% fresh, 100% delicious.
Flowers are nature's expression of love and appreciation. There is no better way to show your love and appreciation than with these beautifully intricate arrangements by Designs by David. Designs by David will deliver beautiful arrangements to you for any occasion, in any city and state around the world. Love and appreciation should be expressed every day. Express it with Designs by David today. Mention Focus with Ron Frierson for a discount.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. So we're back with our guest Kyle Cox, and we're talking about all things economy, jobs, the global order, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And then we're gonna use this to pivot into his business and what he's doing. But before we left, he was talking about, because Kyle is a former military veteran. He was in the United States Navy, and he was saying how we basically have the Navy for the world because there's no other country that can match our Navy. And so I was thinking about this as during the break and how President Trump has increased the defense budget. We already are by far the biggest player on the global stage in regards to our defense capabilities.
No one comes close.
No one even comes close. The next nine countries
combined
don't equal ours. So, and he wants to increase defense again, and he's cutting back on the State Department.
Right.
The part of our federal government that deals with diplomacy and trying to solve conflict over a table by conversation,
right,
as opposed to through military might, he's dumbing down that or shrinking that budget, and he's increasing, which makes you wonder whether or not he's preparing for a fight.
Well, you know? It sounds like he's with North Korea.
He kind of has to. I honestly think that's the only way he can save himself.
Right.
Yeah. You start a war, and then you get all this patriotism behind you.
Exactly.
And then all of a sudden, impeachment stuff doesn't happen anymore. Yeah. Nobody's talking about it.
Right.
You know.
But a war with a nuclear power,
never good.
It's never good, and it's
which nuclear power are we talking about?
North Korea.
Well,
see, and the reason why, and Secretary Tillerson. Our Secretary of State, Secretary Rex Tillerson, was speaking today about him wanting to have bilateral diplomacy with North Korea to get them to get rid of their nuclear weapons and become nuclear free, let them know that they will still be secure if they just cave up there. It's no way in the world they're going to do that.
Listen, no way. If North Korea would just be quiet and develop their program without threatening the United States. In other words, if somebody says they're going to punch you in the nose and they knock on your door, you're going to try to get them first, right? So the United States is in this position where we have to prevent them from punching us in the nose by any means necessary.
Right.
But if Korea would just step back, North Korea would step back and say, you know what? We're not going to threaten the United States anymore. We're going to change our position. Because on one hand, I'm thinking, okay, United States, here we go policing the world again.
Exactly.
Here we go telling another country what they can do. Mm-hmm.
Which is what Trump said he wouldn't do.
Which he said he wouldn't do.
Exactly.
But we're doing it again. We destabilized the Middle East, going in and taking out Saddam Hussein. Mm-hmm. We haven't learned our lesson yet. So Syria, I think, was a good move, bombing the runways.
Yeah.
But again, I'm kind of at that crossroads with North Korea and the United States in this tension that we have going back and forth. If they would just back off the rhetoric, North Korea, I think we could
Actually, with the North Korean thing, I think the reason they do that is because I think he wants us to think he's attention, also he wants us, because it's always resulted in them getting something.
Mm-hmm.
And also he wants to still be on the world stage. And lastly, they saw what happened to Gaddafi in Libya. George W. Bush talked Libyan former President Gaddafi out of Libya to giving up his nuclear weapons, and he gave them up.
Right.
Gaddafi's not there no more.
Yeah, we went in there and took all
We went in and took all that. He, we killed him, or we allowed him to be killed, and Libya is what it is now.
Right.
So anybody that looked at that and said, you know what? We're not giving up our nuclear weapons. That's the only thing that's keeping America from coming and get us.
Exactly.
And that's the reason why Iran wanted to get nuclear weapons, because they see the way we treat North Korea.
Now they have a seat at the table, the negotiating table. We give them more respect when they have nuclear weapons.
Because of that. And then also because of their proximity to South Korea, which is our major ally on the Korean Peninsula.
Oh, yeah.
If we do anything to North Korea, they can always turn and
they
and
can throw a bomb across the border.
Exactly. They can, and it's 20 million people in Seoul, South Korea. So you can have 20 million.
They'll never hit us.
No.
People out there say it can reach the coast. No, it can't. That's the only reason we have Hawaii. That's the reason we took Hawaii. That couldn't happen. Right. So things can't hit California.
Well, let me ask you guys this question. If you think if we were, let's say they cross a line, North Korea cross a line, and Trump decided that we had to move forward in whatever action he deemed necessary. Mm-hmm. Do you think that action would include the total annihilation of Kim Jong-un and North Korea and allow South Korea to then kind of take over and move democracy into North Korea? Or do you think it would just be a strike like similar to Syria?
China won't allow it. That's the key. See, the thing is, China is... The Chinese, okay, let's just say that this is a hypothetical. Well, it's not.
But
really
they still deal with South Korea too. The Chinese.
No.
It would be a bigger economy.
South Korea is our ally.
I understand that, but I'm saying
North Korea is China's ally.
Right. Well, they're also, aren't they allies of China as
they're
well?
They're not allies, but they don't have a contentious. They don't want the reason why North Korea is so close to us is that they don't want China to have a hegemonic influence in the Pacific Rim.
Right.
And so being an ally of the United States kind of gives them some protection from China just coming and taking them over as well. But what President Trump is learning is that the relationship between China and North Korea is tight. It's like me and you.
No,
you can
I understand.
Have somebody come in. You may act crazy. Okay, he's crazy, but that's my boy. He's crazy.
Right.
You know, so it's like that. Right.
Well,
but
what do you think will happen if we do strike back in North Korea? Do you think it would just be a simple strike? Or
you'd have to kill them.
You'll have to kill them, and we'll have to deal with the ramifications.
It couldn't be a serious thing.
And you could not allow someone.
Because he would be mad, and he would do something immediately.
He would do something, and remember where we would have to launch from. We would either have to launch from South Korea, we would have to launch from Japan.
Or we can launch from the ocean.
Or we can launch from the ocean.
It usually comes from the submarine.
And they can see it coming, and in retaliation.
By the time they see it, it's over.
Yeah, but all you got to do is press a button and send a South killer.
Yeah. Yeah.
They already got, and you know, they never really ended the war with South Korea.
Yeah.
They have but it's not, the war is still going on with South Korea, which is crazy.
And this is why I think he'd have, like you said, he's got to kill him. So he's got to annihilate North Korea.
Yeah.
Isn't
that crazy?
They have to have, you know, 100 targets mm-hmm. with 100 yeah. missiles aiming at them. Mm-hmm. And I don't see how they would allow a dictatorship to exist again in North Korea.
No.
Because what are you going to have? The same thing we had in the Middle East where you got
to,
you know.
It would become South Korea. It would just become Korea.
Korea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With South Korea. And it's really interesting what China would do.
Well, China can't do anything.
China's a beast.
They'll deal with it.
They'll deal with it, yeah. But it's really interesting because.
We're the biggest, I think, not consumer. We are one of the largest consumers of the goods from China.
They need us equally economically.
Like exactly. And yep. Right. Yeah. And labor, we use it for labor. It's a symbiotic relationship.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Yeah. So they need us. So, I mean, I'm sure they're doing these calculations. I'm sure they are. And it's, in the meantime, while all of this stuff is going on, you got the thing with Japan and China have their beef. Then you got Taiwan and China mm-hmm. have their beef. And we are, you know, and we're allies with both Japan and
and Taiwan and China.
And then if we do away with China's staunch ally, North Korea, and now they're surrounded by countries that are, you know, allies of the United States, that's why I'm just wondering, like, how will China really react if we did something like that? I think it's easier said than done. Almost everything is easier said than done. Mm-hmm. Is to get China to put pressure on North Korea.
Yeah.
And I don't know what we would have to give up to make China.
Apparently they are doing that. Putting pressure on North Korea, the Chinese.
Yeah,
I mean that's kind of our diplomatic option
because they don't want to see anything happen. They don't want to see anything.
Exactly,
it goes against their interests as well.
Right. Exactly. So
like, it's like telling your friend, like, "Hey, man, calm down."
Yeah. Exactly.
Chill.
Exactly.
Out, man.
Exactly.
Chill.
Like, good.
Exactly.
Before they knock you out.
It's a bunch of girls in here, man. Relax.
Oh, man. Exactly. Exactly.
You're messing it up for all of us.
For all of us. You got everything you need, Kim.
Right. 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 Right.
So listen, we're gonna pivot from that because we could talk about that stuff all day.
Oh, yeah.
We started with the jobs and stuff, and the reason I had Kyle on today is because Kyle's my brother. We play ball together.
Bronco
ball.
Okay.
Bronco
ball. Kyle can hoop too. Kyle can hoop. I don't know if you remember Antoine Joubert. He used to play for Michigan. My people from Michigan remember. Kyle, he's the truth.
He's got that game.
Kyle is the truth.
Okay.
So, appreciate that. Yeah. So. And Kyle, he is one of the lucky people that I know that was able to find a way to monetize his passion, find a way, and to do it in a way that's relevant and cool and is hip, and it makes that he can go to work without feeling like he's at work.
Right.
So I want Kyle to talk about Baller's World. Talk about whatever you want to talk about, man. The show is yours.
Baller's World.
Yeah, that's Baller's World with the Z. Check out the app. It's on iOS. Follow us on social media at Baller's World, or you can go to ballersworld.com with a Z.
Put it up there, Jarvis. Put it on the screen.
I've been working, playing in basketball, working in basketball, living the basketball life my whole life.
Yeah.
And I, working in that side of it, management and whatnot, I kind of go back to what we were talking about earlier. I knew that I needed to do something that was going to be more futuristic because I felt like what I was doing, it just spinning my wheels eventually. And, you know, you kind of hit a plateau and there's really no growth because everybody's doing it. Mm-hmm. So that's when I made the decision after discussing with my family. I said, you know what? I want to get into technology. So my brother and I talked about it. My family talked about it. And he said, hey, you can, instead of going back to school and going in debt, mm-hmm. you know, if you want to learn these skills, you can do the Navy thing or the Air Force thing and they'll pay you to learn this. You just gotta make a little sacrifice. You know, it's gonna suck for a little while, but you gotta do what you gotta do.
How old were you at that point?
I was 29.
Gotcha.
So I had contracts with the Clippers. I was doing things, you know, I had a lot of things going on and I had a restaurant then and I just stopped everything and said, you know what, if I wanna do this, I have to do it now.
That's right.
And so I made that decision, went to the military, got-
Can I time out for a second? I'm sorry. You had a restaurant and a contract with the Clippers.
Yeah, we're doing a lot, like doing the entertainment. I was managing athletes.
Okay.
I was managing.
So you had a successful business and decided to switch
gears. It was semi-successful.
Okay.
It was paying the bills.
Okay.
But I saw where the future was going. I said, I need to get into technology.
Right. Yeah.
And somehow, and then if I could do this, maybe incorporate my passions, like he said, and combine it with this new technology, new information, and skill set.
That's exactly what we were talking about earlier, how people need to go back and get the skill set.
You
got to
make that sacrifice. Right. It's hard to do it because you're starting over pretty much.
Right.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to go to college and take out more debts again because I already got my master's and stuff, and I got debts from, you know, law school and all kind of stuff. So I was like, you know what? Let me just do this. Mm-hmm. So I went and did that and got trained and certified and skilled in all kind of technology related things. Mm-hmm. And that's the old one, but So I went that route, got certified and skilled, and while I was
through
in
the military,
through the Navy, mm-hmm. they paid for everything while I was getting a check, but they paid for all my training and everything, yeah. and I learned it all. And while I was in the military traveling around, still love basketball, and it was like, man, where can we go find basketball games? Where can we connect with people, no matter where we are, who like to hoop?
Right.
Thing, that was Baller's World. Mm-hmm. So I said, well, if there's an app that we can create using GPS technology and, you know, geolocation technology.
Find
games, courts, no matter where you are.
I love it.
So we put that into action, won a bunch of awards. Then I spent another year finding courts all over the world. So I found like 12,000 courts, uploaded those into the app as well. And now the app was an award-winning app in its beta. We're still in our beta, yeah. you know, until it's perfect, mm-hmm. it's still beta. Mm-hmm. But one of these awards where you can connect with other basketball players of equal skill level no matter where you are, find courts anywhere you go. Mm-hmm. But we also saw we needed to pivot and start thinking about revenue, because if you're just scheduling games, you're essentially just a glorified calendar on your phone. So mm-hmm. we said, you know what, that's scalable as far as users, but that's not really as scalable revenue-wise.
Exactly.
So we got into, everybody understands there's two things that's king right now. It's data collection mm-hmm. and content.
Mm-hmm.
So we integrated, we incorporated into our app content aggregation and curation, where you can if you don't feel like playing a game or finding a court, you can watch content being fed live to the app.
So you can actually stream and see a game?
Not streaming the games yet. We're going to add things that people post on their video channels live or mm-hmm. updates live. It comes to our app at mm-hmm. the same time.
Or your live blog, too.
So that's essentially what it is. Yeah. So we have the NBA, everything they feed up, highlight-wise, game-wise, we get it the same exact time they put it on the internet.
Okay.
And all these other companies. So, like, when LaMelo Ball scored 92 points in that one game in high school, we had it before ESPN had it, because we have the people who are there feeding it up to the app beforehand. Okay. You know, we weren't big enough to really let people know we have it before they had it.
Right.
But we know we had it before they had it. So in doing that, we're saying, you know what, and looking at our data, people are – spending a lot of time looking at all this curated and aggregated content that we have. Well, heck, let's make our own content.
There you go.
So we have the resources. Let's make our own content and see if we can monetize that through sponsorships and mm-hmm. and use, you know, getting users and engagement. And it kind of worked out. So right now we pivoted from being just a game locator app to we are the only interactive multimedia basketball platform.
Nice. So it's like a basketball lifestyle.
Exactly, it's a culture. If BallerzWorld is the sun, and all these other entities are the game of basketball. So one planet will be shoes and apparel. One other be leagues, teams, tournaments, clinics. You know, we're just making this, creating this universe around the game of basketball, this culture, and the reason we think that's going to work is because the interactive part of it. You can connect and play and talk to other people who mm-hmm. like basketball, like you do,
right.
but you can also create, watch, and share content.
Nice.
So
I love it.
We're a place where you can play basketball, watch basketball, and then I think this is also the given, because we have a specific niche demographic. We have companies that want to retailers that want to reach that demographic. So we're affiliates with them, and they're selling their products directly to their target consumer.
So you know what's cool about this? That our listeners and some of these youngsters that listen to the show, thinking about a guy by the name of Arion Jones, my nephew. Kyle has done what a lot of people can do, which is this. Find your passion, see how it ties in with mm-hmm. something that's relevant, like technology, and create your own lane in that regard. Because he's taken basketball, he's taken technology, he's taken business, he's found a way to make his own universe, his mm-hmm. own business ecosystem. That's cool. That's real
yeah.
cool. That's
Thank
real
you.
Cool.
Thank you.
And that's exactly what we talked about.
Yeah.
You know?
And that's why it's so. And I think technology, just to kind of bring it back to what we were talking about earlier, mm-hmm. I think that's the new great divide. Mm-hmm. You see what schools are getting the STEM programs and mm-hmm. which schools aren't. It's mm-hmm. obviously, you know what the line is going to be. It's going to be people of color versus people not. People with money versus people without money.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I feel like that's the new great divide, because if this future economy is like we talked about, is all based on either programming, building, mm-hmm. maintaining, operating, or fixing technology, you're going to get left behind. And poor people are going to be a certain class of people, and the people who have these jobs and have money are going to be another class.
Right. Exactly.
And you could usually, like I said, you can tell who is going to be
exactly
just based on how the system is functioning. So I wanted to get in there and do technology, and try to make it cool. You don't have to be a nerd. You don't have to be this socially awkward, Mark Zuckerberg guy with a hoodie on that doesn't talk to people.
Exactly.
You could be a regular dude. We hang out. We're sociable. We can function in rooms and crowds, and we play sports, but we know this technology
stuff.
And I feel like it can be that. It doesn't have to be that.
I like
that
nerd.
Cool. It's cool to be smart.
It's cool to be smart.
Go learn something.
That's so true. It's cool to be smart.
And nobody's talking that. It's all about. Yeah. And I hate sounding I'm sounding like my dad did. But
it happens.
Yeah.
But you hear the music now, and they're just talking about getting high and doing all that stuff, which is, at certain times, nothing wrong. Do what you do. But if you're handling business, you're not gonna have time for that. You understand? There's other things out there than that.
Don't even get me going there. I sometimes think that the moment we start to make strides, something about the culture or the media or what we allow to become popular is something that will allow it's going to set us back.
Right.
So we have on one end, we'll have our first African American president in our country's history. Then at the same time, around that time, you will start to see the degradation of us in certain respects. Mm-hmm. You'll see certain things, certain type of buffoonery.
Now it's cool to be a drug addict.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah. You used to rap.
It's cool to be in the trap. Having your girl mix your stuff up.
Exactly.
And shooting it up.
Exactly.
You think about
Think
about this. Like, how did every indigenous person get conquered? Ever?
Yeah.
The one side knew technology. They understood gunpowder and guns.
Exactly.
And these people are still on horses and bow and arrow.
That's so true.
And the same thing is going to happen now. If you don't have access to the internet, if you don't have access to technology, you don't understand technology, you will be left behind and you will be easily controlled because you don't know anything and you can't function in this world.
And we don't mean just from an end user standpoint. We mean understanding how it works. Because almost all the kids and everyone now has
they can play the game. My 1-year-old son can get through my
head. And understand how data is manipulated to the benefit of the person who's manipulating the data.
Exactly.
And so that we could go on forever about this.
I really believe that's the new social divide.
Yeah.
And that's why I really wanted to, and hopefully this blows.
Say that quote again from Elon Musk you said earlier about capitalism and how people are going to end up.
They said eventually that because every job is going to be technology related, that people aren't, it's not going to be manual labor, that there's the government will be forced to provide a living wage for all citizens.
Check that out. And I see it coming.
Mm-hmm.
I see it coming with
taxes will go through the roof to support that kind of thing.
Exactly.
Right. Exactly.
And I can see why some of the people and policymakers that know this stuff, because if you're sitting at a certain level and you have to look at the trajectory of our civilization, of our country, society, and policies, and how they're going to affect us for the next 20, 30 years, you see things at a different level. So you can see how, again, our population is steadily increasing, whether it's through legal immigration or illegal immigration. And at the same time, birth rates in certain demographics are going up and other demographics are going down. Mm-hmm. But we're still, in aggregate, growing as a population.
Exactly.
Then if you think about the divide between the haves and have-nots, and you think about the educational divide in regards to who's being educated and who's not, those that are being educated, like Kyle said, in certain ways will have to bear the brunt of the social contract in order to take care of the others. Or else you're going to be like some of these other countries we know around the world that we visited, that you either rich or you birth poor.
Yeah. Tell you one other thing. You better learn how to speak Spanish.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Spanish and Mandarin.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. And even with the rich and poor, the rich, basically, they're just going to start building more walls so they can feel safe, because you cannot have a situation where all the wealth is concentrated in a smaller group of people without, it's only human for those people that are down to somehow, in some way, shape, or form, have some sort of social ills like crime and all this stuff that goes up along with tribalism.
Mm-hmm.
I said this once before. I know Woody heard it before. LA, we're very diverse at a certain level.
Yeah.
But then once you start to get down to socioeconomic level, then everybody splits off into their tribes. Mm-hmm. You know,
it's one of the most like liberal segregated cities I've ever seen.
Exactly. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So that's something. We got to take another commercial. Let's take our, I think it'll be our last commercial. Let's take this commercial break and come back with Kyle Cox.
Hi, I'm Dr. Yates. I'm a hair transplant surgeon. When people come to see me, they have a problem. They've lost a lot of hair and they want their hair back. We have our own line of hair products, and I think it's a real winner. The way we start is with Mega Biotin. Number two, edge control. It prevents breakage and holds the edges down. Apple cider vinegar shampoo, it adds body, it adds shine, and it also reduces inflammation. Depending on if your hair is dry, you want to use hydrating. If your hair is thin, you use the thickening shampoo. Then we have our secret sauce, argan oil. With that, we have what's called Miracle Blowout. The Sheen Spray is basically kind of a permutation of the argan oil. It just adds a finishing touch to the hair. And finally, the Dynamic Duo, keratin fibers. This makes your hair look thicker instantaneously. This doesn't come out in the wind, doesn't come out in the rain. We can guarantee this will help your hair and keep you from coming to see me about hair loss.
Jivago timepieces are luxury watches for both women and men. Designs for women are inspired by classic femininity while maintaining their contemporary style. Designs for men blend classic elegance and sporty versatility. All timepieces remain true to the Jivago lifestyle, including their glamorous presentation, which is a nod to the famous Parisian fragrance that started it all. Jivago timepieces transcend the ages, recalling life's most treasured moments. Let Jivago inspire you.
Visit www.jivagowatches.com or shop Jivago Watches on Amazon.
Flowers are nature's expression of love and appreciation. There is no better way to show your love and appreciation than with these beautifully intricate arrangements by Designs by David. Designs by David will deliver beautiful arrangements to you for any occasion, in any city and state around the world. Love and appreciation should be expressed every day. Express it with Designs by David today. Mention Focus with Ron Frierson for a discount.
Welcome back. Welcome back. We've been having a great conversation with my man Kyle Cox of Baller's World.
Baller's World.
Now, you know, my hair is 64. my body is probably 24, and I've been 44 years on this earth.
Right.
My knees are probably about 34. So, is there a way I can find a game on the app, or do I have to just
you got a handicap game?
That's the beauty of the app is that
wheelchair D League.
Right. when you create your profile, you can list your skill level.
Uh-huh.
And we haven't integrated this other feature yet, but it will be to where when you're done playing, peers and yourself, you could do one ranking of yourself in certain skills,
yeah.
But your peers can rate you as well, kind of like Yelp or like Netflix. Like,
got it.
I'm gonna be hooping with the kids. Five stars. I'm gonna be hooping with the 20-year-olds.
So that way, when your name pops up and you're at a game,
yeah.
the average of all the people playing, it'll let you know the skill level of the game you're going to.
Ron gonna be balling with middle school.
Right.
Woody hadn't seen me play, Kyle, so he doesn't know.
He can hoop. Okay. We used to have battles, man. Ron can go.
I heard. Yeah, that's when we had Jamie Foxx's office one day. He was like, "Man, this dude right here,
right?
Oh, yeah. He can hoop."
Yep. Yeah,
yeah. Jamie been at the gym.
Jamie been hooping. And Breon, crazy. Shout out to Breon. Got that knee fixed. I see you Saturday.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, So in regards to ball, now, is this something that's going on in every major city right now, or
it can. Okay. But we're, like I said, we're starting in our backyard,
okay,
as far as our focus. You can't. It's applicable everywhere, literally,
okay,
everywhere. We've been in China. We've tested it in China, Russia, cool, Spain. So it works everywhere, essentially. Yeah.
And there are wheelchair ballers, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, they call it murder ball.
Okay, so that's a part of the.
They can set up their own games as well.
Okay.
No, you just have to let people know what it is.
Right.
You know, like.
You basically use the platform that you've provided to set up everything within, yes, your locale.
Yes.
So the people that are listening right now in New York or in Michigan or in Kansas City or whatever. You know, you can go ahead and use this platform to set up where this right here could go. Hey,
that's huge.
It's a lot of, yeah, play.
It's 500 million people that play basketball every day on it.
Yeah.
It's the most played sport. It's the second most watched behind soccer, but it's the most played on it.
So register your game in your neighborhood.
In your neighborhood, yep, no matter where you are.
And share it.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You know.
But as far as our marketing, we're focusing in our backyard. L.A. right now is like the basketball mecca.
Okay.
I mean, you got 40 dudes in the NBA from L.A. L.A. is like running, but the three MVP candidates are all from
I would
LA.
Never say that. I would never. I'm Michigan all the way.
Who are the three MVP candidates right now? You talking about
Westbrook?
Westbrook, James Harden, and Kawhi Leonard are all from L.A.
Draymond sagging on Michigan.
Paul George from L.A. You know, all these dudes are from L.A.
Right. Yeah.
It's a bunch of them. So,
So
being here, Drew League in the summers, Venice Beach Leagues, all the leagues going on here, we said, let's just focus here and really build it here because if it grows here, then those guys' network and that reach will expand everywhere because they're global. And L.A., people are following what we're doing in L.A.
And you've had some professional guest on as a part of the
– Yeah. We do a weekly show called Ballers World Live.
Okay.
We stream it and record it every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Then it re-airs on ESPN Radio 1700 every Sunday.
Ballers World. Live.com?
No, it's .com.
Okay,
you just go to everything's through Ballers World, but the show is called Ballers World Live.
Ballers World Live.
Yeah, just follow us on social media. You'll see all the streams and everything. And we've had, like I said, Byron Scott, Tracy Murray, Jimmy Jackson, Moochie Norris, a host of influencers and comedians.
Mm-hmm.
Markel Fultz came on, who's probably going to be the number one pick in the draft.
Yeah.
De'Aaron Fox from Kentucky is coming on this week.
Yeah.
Nice.
And, you know, we're trying to get LeVar Ball and the Ball Brothers on there. We're reaching out to them, so we're trying to get them on because they're, you know, they're the hot topic right now.
Yeah. What's up?
Hey, so listen, so I got to ask. I hope it don't mess you up getting him on the show. What do you think about his father and how he's getting all this media?
With two parts.
Yeah.
From a marketing standpoint, it's genius.
Yeah.
Right.
We also were talking about him.
Right. Yeah.
Their social media followings are out the through
off
the roof,
charts.
A million each, and they're selling a brand, which I think is smart. But because, and people don't know this, with the NCAA, if you're doing something before you sign your letter of intent, you can continue to do it afterwards. So if you're a model or an actor or you have a product or a family thing, you can do that without it being a violation.
Okay.
So it's smart because they have their own brand. They have their own social media. They're modeling their own stuff. Okay. So once they go to UCLA, they can never stop. They don't have to stop doing that like everybody else would.
Okay.
So he's playing the fool and the buffoon, but he's really laughing to the bank as far as, you know, futuristically.
Right.
But I think on the flip side, he's burning bridges for his kids because you're talking mess about guys that he may be playing on the same team with.
Yeah,
exactly.
You know, and you look at what happened today. I think it just came out today. Nike, Under Armour, and Adidas all turned down working with them because he insulted all three of those companies' top player.
Yeah.
Wow. Steph, LeBron, Harden, he clowned all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And they're the number one guys at each of those companies. So if LeBron probably said, no, you don't sign him.
Right.
You know, Steph said, nah, man, I'm not messing with that dude.
And then we've seen so many. It's very seldom that you see a LeBron or a Kobe, someone who's come out with a lot of hype that's actually lived up to the hype.
Who lived up to the hype. That's
remember,
key, Ron.
Yeah, remember,
lived up to the hype.
Exactly. Remember Felipe Lopez?
Remember Sam Bowie?
Yeah, exactly.
Felipe was the best player on Earth.
On Earth, exactly. Yeah. So remember, there's so many players that come out that they say this is going to be the next coming of whoever, and it never turns out to be that way. You don't know what your son is going to be. Of course, you have all the best wishes for him and, you know, highest aspirations for him, but you don't know, and yet you're burning bridges, putting undue pressure on him.
Because once they get in the bright lights, everything changes.
And now everybody's gunning for you. You got to think, these are not the high school kids you've been playing against or college. These are grown. Everybody you're playing against averaged 20 and 10 where they were before.
It's almost like his father is trying to get himself a reality show.
And that's my problem. I think he wants to be a star. From a business standpoint, from all that, and supporting your kids, I'm all in.
Exactly. And you know
when
what?
You're trying to be more famous than them, now I have a problem.
That's what it seems like.
He'll probably get one.
He'll probably
he's
get
doing sketches with comedians and stuff now. Like
But you know what?
But they're being talked about, and that brand, if it gets distributed by somebody, could really benefit them later because they have their own thing. They have their own agency. They're not going with any agents. And I love that part of it. I love that keeping in nepotism because everybody else has been doing that, but black people for years.
Exactly.
You know, so I think that's smart.
Right.
But like you guys said, the putting the pressure, burning bridges, and just putting his kid in the spotlight when obviously that kid doesn't have that kind of personality. He's
like a
quiet, Kawhi Leonard
kind of guy. Yeah, and also he's been dealing with this type of personality being his father his entire life. So I'm sure he knows how to kind of, you know, shelter himself away from
That's what I'm saying. There's got to be some aspect of this kid that's that maybe not be the same as his dad, and they may give him a break for that.
I like the kids. They're good.
They're good kids, right?
So quiet and humble. They don't really. They're not the ones doing any trash talking.
They're not fully damaged yet.
So hopefully the sins of the father won't. You know, you don't have to worry about.
And pops might be doing what he needs to do.
But go through those kind of parents. Yeah. The list of them. How's that relationship with the kid now?
Right. Exactly.
Right. Joe Jackson.
Oh yeah.
Matthew Knowles.
Right. Yeah.
Serena Williams' dad.
Kobe.
Yeah. Kobe's. They don't even talk to their parents.
Exactly.
You know, they're there in the beginning, but once they can make decisions.
Well, hopefully, LeVar, a look at those case studies you just spoke about. Yeah. So, guys, listen, this has been an excellent, excellent, excellent conversation.
Over?
It's close to it, but not quite yet.
Okay.
So I want us to really take home with Kyle the real point was that one of the things and one of the reasons I wanted Kyle to come on the show is because, number one, I like people who do things that are out of the box. Now, we've had Byron and Charlie on here. We've had Dr. Steve Poulton, a great show. And Kyle is a young African-American who's in the world of technology and also in the world of technology, like you said, where you can be smart and you can be cool at the same time. And also, as you could tell from our conversations earlier, he's also knowledgeable about our main focus on the show, which is politics, geopolitics, and how it relates to everyday life. Mm-hmm. Because one of the major things that I try to preach on the show, Kyle, is to become involved, be engaged, know what's going on around you.
Yeah.
Understand that it's necessary to pick up a newspaper. Mm-hmm. It's necessary to watch the news from time to time, especially if you find an informative program like a Fareed Zakaria, mm-hmm. who I love,
or Focus or with Ron Frierson, mm-hmm.
or Focus with Ron Frierson, or something like that. But just to feed your mind and not just turn on and watch hip hop, loving hip hop, everything. Know what's going on around you,
and don't believe everything you're seeing on the radio.
Exactly. And if that's too deep for you, there's lighter versions of it, like Bill Maher.
Exactly.
Or Trevor Noah. Right.
There you go.
Those guys. You can watch those guys and give you just as much information,
exactly.
but with a lighter touch to
exactly.
it.
Exactly. They'll put some sugar with the with the medicine.
Right. Right.
You know? So yeah, so Kyle, you gotta tell us again, Baller's World, where to go, what time, with all the stuff. Tell us one more time.
Baller's World with a Z. BallersWorld.com, at Baller's World on all our social media across the board. Mm-hmm. Wednesdays, follow our social media for the live streams. Wednesdays nights at 7 p.m. every Wednesday. Mm-hmm. And it re-airs ESPN 1700 Sunday morning at 9 a.m.
Come up there.
That's what's up.
Y'all.
Well, listen, everyone.
And only on iOS right now. We're coming on. We'll be on Android soon.
And, guys, if you guys have any ideas for the show, or something you want to tell me, feel free to email me at ronnie.frierson@gmail.com. It's really important that you put focus in the subject line so I know what you're emailing me about, okay? Again, ronnie.frierson@gmail.com. Also, we're on every Friday, 5 to 6. Chime in. Next week, we didn't have time to take calls this week, but next week, be sure to jot down a phone number, 323-843-2826. Again, 323-843-2826. Thank you. Support our sponsors because they're the ones that keep us on the air. The moment they dry up, everybody, I'm out. The moment they dry up, so just get ready for it.
Yes.
So you gotta support the sponsors. So anyway, thank
you. It's Friday, y'all.
To Woody. Thank you to Kyle.
Thank you, man.
Thank you to the audience out there for supporting this show and starting your weekend with us. And we'll see you next week.
Be safe out there.
Peace.
Yeah.